Always a difficult subject. Predicting the future is a hazardous occupation at the best of times, and it's, I think, fair to say these are not the best of times.
Sir Fred Goodwin, Knight of the Realm for services to banking, was the chief executive of the Royal Bank of Scotland when it ran up the biggest corporate loss in British history. A loss of £24.1 billion. In the good times, the Royal Bank of Scotland grew faster than any other British bank. It pulled off record-breaking deals, made billions of pounds in investment banking. Its top executives drove the bank forward to become, at one point, the world's biggest bank, and collected fabulous bonuses along the way.
Thanks.
Then, in October 2008, RBS came within hours of running out of money.
Any news on the banking bailout, Lady Badera?
And had to be bailed out by the British taxpayer.
Decision time, Governor.
RBS wasn't the only bank to be rescued, but by the time of the financial crash, it was the most toxic bank in Britain.
What's your message to shareholders? Are you sorry?
You won't hear me.
And that's something that didn't need to happen.
Andrew Johnson from the Daily Express. So Fred, I was just wondering, give us some idea why you're the right man to lead the bank, you know, out of the situation it now finds itself in, given the fact that I suppose what's happened has been some sort of failure of risk management, which is one of the core competencies a bank is supposed to have.
It's not me solely that runs the bank. There are a team of people here who run the bank, and we're sort of one mind of the need to go forward from the position we're in. We're in the middle of a financial markets crisis where there seems to be some debate as to whether it's the worst for a generation, for in 70 years or some other longer period. But it's certainly the case that it's in that the industry is in a tight place, and as a major participant in that industry, we're in a tight place. We also have
been in a job too long. For instance, there have been studies which show chief executives start losing their effectiveness after, you know, around 7 years in the job.
I'm sure there are studies, Andy, but I always find things to do with individuals. It's very hard to pin down at 7 years. I don't know how long reporters have to report for before they lose their effectiveness, Andrew. But
too long.
I'd be reluctant to sign into any of those particular things. I wouldn't do this job forever, but right now, you find me extremely galvanised to the task at hand. We've got a big task at hand, and my colleagues and I are of one mind and of one focus to get through this.
This is a film about Scotland's largest bank, up to date and looking after every aspect of your business life. It's a friendly bank too. It's the Royal Bank.
It was certainly seen as a Scottish bank with a Scottish identity, but one that was looking to do things somewhat differently and was not the same as the run-of-the-mill and slightly larger banks that dominated the scene across the UK at the time.
The Royal Bank of Scotland was a Scottish institution, prudent, effective and ambitious. In 1998, its dynamic and successful chief executive, George Matthewson, was looking for new blood to lead the bank forward.
I was actually looking for a finance director, but we would like one who had the potential, possibly, to become chief executive, because obviously replacing me was on my mind, as well as other people's minds. And I thought, well, wait a minute, we do have Fred Goodwin. Right here in Scotland. He did strike me as someone who could lead. I just felt that he had a lot to offer.
Fred was the rising star of Scottish banking, a chartered accountant charge of Clydesdale Bank before he was 40. There, he had earned a reputation for cost-cutting and acquired his enduring nickname.
The Fred the Shred reputation was there, that this was a tough, hard man. No one doubted his intelligence and his determination, but he did have that that reputation for being quite difficult as a boss and quite quite hard on stuff.
My first hearing that Fred Goodwin was coming on board was a call from the Clydesdale Bank, where they had been celebrating his departure for 3 days now, and they wished us all the very best of luck. And that was my first introduction to the name of Goodwin. I will not forget it.
With George and Fred at the helm, Scotland was no longer big enough to contain RBS's ambitions. They aimed to grow RBS into an international banking force. But they weren't the only ambitious Scottish bank. Their Edinburgh rival, the Bank of Scotland, was also hungry for growth. And both banks faced the same obstacle.
Both Bank of Scotland and Royal Bank had the same problem, didn't they? At the end of the day, they were anchored in a quite small economy in their home market. Both of them took the view that they had to actually make a jump to something bigger to actually avoid their over-dependence on the Scottish economy.
The quickest and the boldest way to achieve this was by carrying out a takeover. Traditionally in banking, takeovers involved bigger banks buying up smaller ones. But that's not what RBS had in mind. First, RBS audaciously sniffed around Barclays. But they were warned off by the city. Then, they both began to look at another venerable city institution. NatWest, a bank more than twice their size.
They say that when a company builds a new head office, it gets a corporate jet and has a fountain and a flagpole, it's time to sell the shares. NatWest built the NatWest Tower.
NatWest Bank was huge but ailing. Its share price was low. And it was Bank of Scotland that moved first.
What we see with NatWest is a hugely undervalued opportunity. It's undermanaged, it's underperforming. It's a great franchise, and we believe that we can help turn it around.
I was at the Ryder Cup, and my phone went illegally, because you're not supposed to have a phone at the Ryder Cup. And they said, you have to come back, Bank of Scotland have just bid for NatWest. We had a meeting in London, I remember, with our investment banks, and they were all saying, you must bid. And I said, no. We will bid when we know as much as it's possible to know.
A few weeks later, RBS did join the takeover battle, promising bigger savings. George did the strategy, Fred mastered the detail, and set about convincing the city that RBS could pull it off.
The bulk of the cost savings relate to back office processing, to head office areas and so on. They don't relate to customer facing staff.
I think there was incredulity that two small banks could actually have the nerve, and I use the word the nerve, to actually go for this bastion of the British banking industry. And I know that some of the management actually felt quite let down by the city, that the city could actually take seriously a bid of this nature.
Yes, there were doubters, but the general feeling at the time in the city was that anything other than the current NatWest management.
After a hard-fought takeover battle, NatWest shareholders had to decide where their bank's future lay.
It was a close-run thing. In fact, at lunchtime on the last day, I thought we'd won. And then the tide swung against us in the afternoon. I was monumentally pissed off. But at the end of the day, now that was the shareholders' decision.
It was elation for about 10 minutes. No, it was elation for a day or two, but that's it. At that stage, I stepped back
become deputy chairman, and there was never any questioning of whether Fred Goodwin was not the right man to take over the new RBS.
Fred and George had arrived on the big stage. As the savings, including 18,000 job cuts and integrations, were made, it became clear that not only had they done the biggest hostile takeover in UK history, but they had done it brilliantly. Fred got a bonus of £800,000, and George one of £750,000, which, he insisted, would barely give him bragging rights in a Soho wine bar.
The NatWest deal was an extraordinary exercise in putting together two banks, and the management team of RBS with a very strong following in the city. You've got a strong following in the city. It means on the whole that your share price looks better because investors want to buy your shares. It means that people believe in your story, so they encourage you in many ways to do more deals because that's what's working.
The bank's share price dipped a little, then jumped up. RBS now had access to the huge vault of NatWest's savings and deposits. The question was, what to do with them? The answer was, spend them. They bought another insurance company, a credit card operation in Germany, and a second-hand car franchise.
Acquisitions, what can I say to you? Acquisitions that hasn't been said before.
Along the way, Fred Goodwin picked up a knighthood.
We don't do acquisitions for fun.
And was acclaimed by Forbes Global magazine as its businessman of the year.
We're like puppies, we don't buy them just for Christmas. And if there's no acquisitions that make sense, we're not going to do any.
The place that made most sense for RBS to do acquisitions was the USA, the biggest market in the world, where thousands of little banks sat waiting to be gobbled up. And RBS already had an American arm called Citizens. Citizens was run prudently by Larry Fish.
We're very proud of our credit record over a long period of time. So we've avoided unsecured lending both to the consumer and to the corporate sector.
Larry Fish would always say, well, in the mornings I take deposits, and later in the morning I take some more deposits. After lunch, yeah, I'll take some more deposits. I'm feeling very brave. I may lend a little bit of money. Citizens was a community bank. It was the third largest bank in Rhode Island or something, which is not a major claim to fame. But it was very community-based, very customer-based. And it was big in its small areas.
But RBS wanted Citizens to be big in bigger areas. And Larry embarked on an acquisition spree of his own. A prudent acquisition spree, buying up other small banks dotted around New England, then stripping out costs and selling new financial products to the customers. In 2001, Larry Fish raised the stakes and expanded Citizens West into the huge Philadelphia market, spending $2 billion on a bank called Mellon Financial. This deal made Citizens big in a much bigger area and earned it a starring role in RBS's next corporate video, alongside its many other impressive purchases and interests. RBS was, by some measures, the fifth biggest bank in the world, headquarters of an international banking group. But there was a price to all this growth. The culture inside the bank had changed. We lost a lot of the collegiate atmosphere. I mean, it was, under George, it was very much he wanted to hear what people had to say, and he wanted to discuss, and he wanted to bring people in, and that was lost to a considerable extent.
George was very charismatic. He was extremely well liked and respected by many who worked for him. Fred, I think, was more efficient. Probably the best description.
He can be a little too acerbic. He's not very good at suffering fools gladly. In fact, he can be quite forbidding.
Fred had a very impressive intellect, but he used that to bully those around him. People were intimidated from speaking their own mind because they feared Fred's reaction. And this created an atmosphere around him which inhibited even the most senior people in the bank from expressing their views.
This atmosphere was apparent at the highest level in the bank.
The morning meeting was a particular RBS innovation that they brought into NatWest. And the top management team of 7 or 8 people would get together every day on anything up to 4 video conference screens, and essentially in half an hour or 2 hours or however long was necessary, we'd thrash out the problems of the day.
The morning meetings were quickly became known somewhat whimsically as the morning beatings, and Fred seemed to just at random decide of which senior executive was going to be roasted that day. It wasn't nice to be part of, but on the other hand, you kind of, somewhere in the back of your mind, you were saying, well, at least it's not me. Suck it up, I think, was a phrase that was used. That's life in the big city. Asleep at the wheel, he was quite keen at asleep at the wheel.
I always believe that there are many ways of skinning a cat as far as leadership is concerned. And I don't go along with people who say there's one way of doing this. And so Fred it his way, and for long enough it was very effective.
Fred proved to be particularly effective for RBS shareholders. Despite, or perhaps because of, his robust management style, Fred got results. In other words, he delivered profits year after year as the bank grew. In May 2004, the moment RBS had been waiting for finally arrived. A deal that would transform Citizens from a big regional bank into one of the biggest banks in America. The target was a bank called Charter One.
Charter One was put to us by Larry Fish.
Citizens has done this kind of thing before. You've heard me say before all the acquisitions we've done, the 24, 25 acquisitions we've done previously.
We had a very successful acquisition and integration record. He had a mantra of low risk.
Charter One would expand Larry Fish's empire and RBS into the huge Chicago market with its millions of households and potential customers.
It is a very logical geographical extension to our business in the United States. It is a significant increase in scale, there's no doubt about that. And overall, we think that there is a low risk acquisition to execute and implement the benefits.
Fred and the board backed Larry's deal, and RBS made a huge offer of $10.5 billion. RBS became the seventh biggest bank in the USA. But
they didn't stop there. Shortly afterwards, RBS bought a near £1 billion stake in the Bank of China, which came with a place on the board for Fred. RBS was now a global colossus, and in need of a new home. The 14th of September 2005 was a big day in RBS's history. A new purpose-built headquarters in Edinburgh was being opened by the Queen, just as she had opened the NatWest Tower 24 years earlier. Headquarters was a work of wonder. It certainly had a fountain, and it was built right next to Edinburgh Airport, where the bank's private jet would whisk senior executives across the world. While RBS bosses mingled with royalty, city analysts were less impressed, and wondering if the time had come to sell RBS shares. The bank's share price wasn't performing as well as expected. The problem was Charter One. RBS was struggling to make its usual savings and grow its usual profits. And the city thought Fred and his bank had paid far too much.
So was it a good deal?
Well, in retrospect, it certainly wasn't a good deal. I would say that it was oversold to us.
The city bought into the deal, but I think they were sceptical. And personally, my own view is that they never really accepted that it had been a success. And there was a degree of scepticism introduced into the RBS story, really for the first time in our history.
The city's scepticism about the bank's buying spree came out at an analyst conference around this time.
Well, I think there's a perception among some investors that Fred Goodwin's a megalomaniac who pursues size over shareholder value.
I saw it the first time I've heard that, and I'm sure that's what you think. I'm sure there are people who think that, if only because you wrote it, so there must be at least one person who thinks it. I really don't think it stands a lot of scrutiny in terms of what we've actually done. I think the results you're seeing today demonstrate delivery against a quite clear, coherent strategy, and one which we've executed with considerable internal discipline.
Up until Charter One, Fred Goodwin had pretty much a free rein on any acquisition he'd wanted to do. Him and his team had pulled off something like 20 deals since NatWest in 2000. That's just a four-year period. What Charter One did was make the city step back and think about the price RBS was paying, the way it was paying for deals, and crucially, people started to look at the underlying business and look for the actual growth that was taking place within the existing businesses.
By 2005, Fred's RBS had acquired 25 assorted businesses. It had spent nearly £30 billion, but its shareholders now demanded an end to deals and takeovers. RBS could still expand by making money out of money, which was another way of saying corporate and especially investment banking. In 2005, RBS's investment bank was run by Johnny Cameron, the son of one of the bank's former vice chairmen and a financial wizard in his own right.
I and my management team make a huge effort to walk the talk. We talk about being insurgent. We talk about restless success. We may be successful, but we're still restless. We talk about keeping the magic, is another phrase. There is some magic about what we've got in CBFO, about our culture. We need to retain that even while growing into this international business.
Johnny Cameron's investment bank took savers' money from NatWest and RBS accounts and invested it in a whole range of highly lucrative ways. sitting within the investment bank was a small specialist outfit called RBS Greenwich Capital, tucked away in a quiet corner of Connecticut.
We'd inherited Greenwich with NatWest, and I went there, and it was full of very clever, very bright people. It also had some of the best risk management that I'd seen anywhere at the time. You got kind of instant results next day of what Greenwich had been doing, what risks they'd been taking, how they'd been managing them, and all the rest of it. I thought, well, there is a reasonable chance that we could actually grow that business.
Greenwich Capital made money out of mortgages, not as a lender to house buyers, but as a trader. It bought huge bundles of thousands of ordinary domestic mortgages, safe prime loans, from banks and other lenders across the USA. Then, it packaged these up, sliced, diced, and sold them on to investors who profited from the interest.
It really did seem as if the bankers had stumbled on a new form of alchemy. They were taking straw and turning it into gold by virtue of all this slicing and dicing. Because as they kept slicing and dicing these loans, the banks kept skimming off profits, and Greenwich Capital was absolutely at the forefront of taking those mortgages and trying to find new innovative ways of actually essentially making money for the bank.
Trading was where the big money could be made.
Consumers were certainly interested in housing, and it became a bubble. As time went on, banks began to run out of people to lend to. A lot of people owned houses already. Yeah, maybe they were refinancing, but there were only so many times you could do that. And of course, most people with a lot of income and good credit already owned a house. So if you're looking for new customers, where did you go? You went to people who didn't have credit, people who didn't have a house, people in many instances who didn't have money.
These people were known as subprime borrowers and were encouraged to take on huge mortgages, which, although slightly riskier, were also sliced, diced, and traded. As long as they kept paying their mortgages, traders and investors would keep getting rich.
Well, this was a business that was built on debt. It was debt, layered on debt, leavened with debt, sprinkled with debt. Debt was built into this at every layer.
RBS Greenwich Capital moved up the league table of mortgage traders, competing all the way with the biggest Wall Street firms. Some of its trading was prime, some subprime, and some exotic cocktails of both prime and subprime all mixed up together. Ever more complex packages, and all of it highly lucrative.
The most important impression I want to leave you with is this is a great business.
You have to remember some of the smartest people in the world working in this. You know, top mathematicians, top physicists. They weren't working in universities anymore. They weren't working in nuclear establishments. They were running complex financial models to see how they could model risk and how they could predict the future. That was where the income was. You packaged it all up into big numbers, and you could make tens of millions of pounds in these deals.
Tens of millions?
Oh, yeah, yes, absolutely.
In 2004, the profits of Johnny Cannon's part of the bank grew by nearly 18% on the previous year. In 2005, its profits were up another 22%. brand that accounted for almost two-thirds of the entire RBS profit.
It grew like Topsy.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our 2006 interim results presentation. It's a special pleasure for me to welcome you today, as this is our first set of results since my taking over as chairman.
In 2006, the success story continued, and with Sir George Matthewson retired as chairman, it was down to new boy Sir Tom McKillop to deliver the good news.
Total income for the first half rose by 10% to £13.642 billion. This resulted in group operating profit rising by 15% to over £4.6 billion. I believe today's results, based as they are purely on organic growth, amply demonstrate these fundamental strengths of the group and the sustainability of our operations.
Over half of the profit that year came directly from Johnny's banks.
I'm very, very comfortable and happy with the platform we built in GBM. It's paying off very well. I think our results in GBM are absolutely first class for the businesses we're in. But yeah, there are things we can do more, and we will do more. That's part of the excitement. We have further things that we can grow and do more in, as Fred indicated.
Following on from these results, the city began to believe once more in the RBS story, and the bank's share price inched back up. RBS allowed itself another glitzy pat on the back.
If we were wanting to build what we have today, from today, it really couldn't be done.
The bank's senior managers targeted more growth.
We have a good story to tell in terms of what's happening at the moment, and equally, I remain extremely excited by what's in front of us.
Everyone seemed to be benefiting from this magical new form of banking. And nobody likes to admit they didn't really understand things. There's a sense of pride involved about it. And so as a result, the bankers were allowed to carry on doing what they're doing, largely unscrutinized. And they didn't understand the risk that their own banks were running.
Just as everything was looking rosy for RBS, the engine driving the growth of the entire banking industry ran out of steam. In late 2006, the American housing bubble well and truly burst. As American interest rates went up, many of those with subprime mortgages could no longer afford their loans. So they stopped paying. Anxiety spread throughout the markets and across continents.
So a big wake-up call for the UK, for the analysts and the investors in the UK, as far as subprime was concerned, was this profit warning from HSBC at the beginning of 2007, where it revealed that it had suffered heavy losses, much heavier than expected, on its portfolio of subprime mortgage loans in the US. And at that point, people started looking around saying, well,
Who else has got these kind of loans?
RBS reassured the city that they won't end subprime lending.
We have prime quality portfolios, both at Citizens, where we do not do subprime lending.
The fact we don't become involved in subprime lending has been another landmine we've kept away from. I think we've seen evidence in the market that that has been a good place not to be.
But all that slicing and dicing of mortgage debt meant there was no escape.
What happened in the system was that subprime became such a big part of what banks did. Not just originating it, but buying it, lending to the people who did it, packaging them, selling them, structuring them, trading them. It infected the whole system. So every bank did subprime.
What's the warehousing exposure you've got in the mortgage bank?
Analysts wanted to know how much subprime RBS held in its investment banks.
The amount of subprime, sub-investment grade exposure we have across both the warehouses and collateralized lending and residual interest, whichever way you look at it, is really very, very, very small. A minuscule amount of that, a minimal amount of that, those totals.
Good morning, everyone. I'd like to...
We have a minuscule subprime problem. The investment banks were in great shape. And Fred was optimistic about the future.
In short, we faced 2007 with some confidence. So, thank you very much.
But if the American housing market was in decline, how would RBS grow now?
As long as I've been writing about RBS, people have been speculating about RBS making another big acquisition. And so there was a sense, really, that, you know, when possible, when the conditions allowed it, that Fred Goodwin was really keen to do another big deal.
I'm just wondering if you could give us some sense of how you feel at the moment or in the coming year about the possibility of acquisitions and whether you think that you're kind of out of the sin bin as far as your investors are concerned when it comes to future deals.
Yeah, I think we're out of the sin bin, but I don't think that equates to, you know, going out to make acquisitions. I mean, we've been pretty clear all along in terms of our guidance about acquisitions, and there's no change being signalled at this point. As much as anything else, Peter, the outlook is conditioned by availability. I can't think there's anything out there at the moment that seems to us desirable, doable, or affordable.
I and everybody else interpreted as a sign that really there were no big acquisitions on the horizon at the moment. And in retrospect, obviously, that turned out to be not the case.
Fred Goodwin announced the biggest banking takeover in history. The target was a Dutch bank, one of Europe's largest, called ABN AMRO. ABN AMRO contained an American bank, a Brazilian bank, banks in Italy, in Holland, in India, an investment bank which sprawled across the globe. It was big, unwieldy, and badly run. For the second time in less than a decade, RBS entered a huge hostile takeover battle after a competitor moved first. This time it was Barclays Bank that announced a friendly merger with ABN AMRO. So Fred and his advisors put together a consortium of three banks to launch a not-so-friendly takeover.
Well, the most important thing, of course, is that Barclays was going to buy the whole of ABN AMRO. And they talked at the time of a merger of equals. Whereas the consortium, the bid of the consortium, was not friendly. It was aggressive. RBS, Santander, and Fortis, they all wanted separate parts of the bank. And they were going to tear it up in three, maybe four parts. It wasn't something which was wanted by the management of ABN AMRO, clearly.
RBS's share of the spoils would include the investment bank and the American operation, a large bank based in Chicago called LaSalle, which would give RBS access to the lucrative American corporate market. But ABN AMRO Fred's management was fighting for survival. To thwart Fred and scupper the consortium, they sold off LaSalle.
Quite a few people were convinced that RBS would sort of throw in the towel after the announcement that LaSalle was going to be sold, because we all knew that the investment bank was not that successful. So why would RBS want to spend so much money on something which is not very successful?
ABN AMRO has many good businesses, many attractive franchises, and operates in many attractive markets. That, again, is something that perhaps has got a little bit lost in all of the rhetoric that has been around the subject.
RBS pressed ahead regardless. In a conference call to analysts, Fred announced that there would be no major scrutiny of the ABN AMRO books. A process called due diligence.
Thank you. Right. We're talking about a public company, a company that's regulated in many different countries, a company which has already had due diligence done on it to result in Barclays being taken off it. So I don't think we need to conduct a major due diligence exercise. I think we'll be sort of due diligence in mind to maybe what we would be wanting to do.
Diligence you need to do in order to make sure that you know what you're buying, to check what you're buying. If it's really true what the bank promises to be, you want to check it. Therefore, it surprised me that a due diligence light could do the trick. It's unbelievable.
Growth prospects.
A due diligence light is good enough for me? Come on, you're spending so much money. You take a big risk here.
I don't think they had any idea what they were buying. I think almost every question that you asked on that respect, that the answer came back was, well, when we did NatWest, we did it like this, and that's what we're going to do again.
I mean, I think it's worth comparing it to our experience with NatWest. Certainly, we've only had very limited due diligence, but that interview when I went over there filled me with enormous confidence, particularly about the cost synergies.
RBS was filled with such confidence that they offered 27 billion euros for their share of the massive deal. However, while Dutch regulators were delaying the ABN AMRO deal being signed off, it became clear that the subprime problem wasn't going away. In fact, it was getting worse. The crisis was spreading from lenders up the food chain to penetrating investment banks. There was no knowing where it might end.
By the time that RBS was buying ABN AMRO, there were definitely people saying that this deal is completely mad.
I think there was definitely some pressure put on RBS from ABN AMRO investors, from its partners in the consortium, particularly Santander. I think there was quite a lot of pressure put on them to kind of see the deal through. And I think there was probably also an element of pride on Fred Goodwin's part.
I have no idea why Royal Bank didn't walk away. They could have walked away. Life obviously was getting tougher, and yet they still continued to pay top dollar. There would undoubtedly have been a penalty for walking away from it, but it would have been a very, very cheap penalty.
The board of RBS unanimously approved the deal, and RBS went ahead with the biggest banking takeover in history, and took the unusual step of paying mostly in cash from the bank's reserves.
Welcome to our interim results presentation.
At the next RBS results meeting, optimism prevailed.
And here at RBS, business is very good indeed.
The short answer is we're kind of one step removed from it. We've never lent directly to people who are involved, who are the customers in subprime, so we stand back from that. We have a business in the United States that's involved in the packaging of those debts through for onward sale to investors. So we see what's happening. It's affecting a market in which we operate, but it's not impacting us in the direct way in which it's impacting on some others. I don't know, Johnny, if there's anything you wanted to add.
I think the complexity of some of the products they were involved in were part of the problem, and perhaps the kind of interpretation that could be put in some of Fred's statements about not being, you know, not doing subprime and not really, you know, having ownership of those assets, just being agents, the kind of interpretation would be that perhaps he didn't really understand that fully himself. But they certainly were very complicated products, and I think perhaps only one or two of the directors might really have understood that properly.
I remember 6 months ago there was a lot of speculation ahead of our annual results presentation that we were going to be very adversely affected by the subprime situation. It just didn't happen. We said it wouldn't happen, and you've seen it again today. You know, we are not operating in that direct space.
The directors reassured the city that RBS's investment bank was still in good health.
We cut back a lot since the year end of 06 in our exposure to these sorts of markets, and I told you then that they were very modest. We've taken no credit losses anywhere in the portfolio. Generally, you know, while volatility has made for some difficulties, it's made for some opportunities as well.
In September, the subprime crisis finally spread to Britain's High Street. Northern Rock experienced the first run on a bank in the UK for nearly 150 years. The markets went into turmoil. Shortly afterwards, and to its dismay, RBS was finally able to discover just what ABN AMRO had on its books. It was not good news. It contained exposure to hundreds of millions of pounds of subprime-related investments, which were turning toxic. RBS could reassure the city no longer. And Johnny's own investment bank was also on the slide. In December, the bank disclosed that it had suffered deep subprime-related losses. Fred announced that RBS was writing off £1.5 billion.
The August that we saw in 2006-2007 was clearly the creation, to a much greater extent than other banks, of Fred Goodwin as its chief executive. One of the big mysteries for me, one of the things that still really hasn't quite become clear, is why this man who had this tremendous attention to detail knew so little about what was going on in this giant investment bank.
I think what people saw was this huge global bank sitting on their doorstep, which had grown in a short space of time from humble beginnings to become a powerhouse globally. And it was difficult to equate that with a bank that really could have problems.
The losses didn't stop there. In January and February, billions were wiped off the value of RBS's investments. They had been sliced, diced, and finally trashed. Its cash reserves, drained by the purchase of ABN AMRO, were struggling to take the strain. One vital measure of its financial health, its so-called Core Equity Tier 1 ratio, was getting dangerously low. Analysts wanted to know just how low.
Well, now, as ever, try and answer any questions you might have. Thanks.
Can you tell us what is the Core Equity Tier 1 ratio on a kind of a look-through basis, so excluding the pieces of ABN that you don't own? Are you saying it's a number that you know and you don't want to share it with us, or is not knowable?
It's a number that you can work out. It's not a number that we can ever realise, because we will never get to the point where we can split it up to do that. It does begin with a 4, and it does begin with a 7. As much as we would like to say at this point.
So we can work out, or you can work out, I'm just confused. Well, can you just tell us what the number is then?
You make some assumptions, but it's not a meaningful number in terms of how we operate right now. I mean, because the group is the group.
City analysts grew increasingly convinced that RBS would be forced to ask shareholders for more cash. In financial jargon, an inorganic capital raising.
Accurately describe what we're planning to do. There are no plans for any inorganic capital raisings or anything of the sort.
I remember February 2008, Fred Goodwin being asked about it repeatedly and insisting that there were no plans for any kind of what he called inorganic capital raising exercise, which was proved not to be the case several weeks later.
As the losses mounted, RBS did ask shareholders for help.
People stopped believing what he said. And I think when you run a bank, which depends essentially on confidence to survive, when people stop believing what you say, that's fatal.
Do I worry?
RBS was running out of money.
Do I worry?
More heavy losses came in the spring. By April, there were £6 billion of them.
Do I give a bag of beans?
The bank pleaded for double that, for £12 billion, to stay afloat.
And when evening shadows creep, do I lose any sleep?
Shareholders were reassured this would secure the bank's future for at least a year.
As you all know, this morning we announced a loss before tax of £691 million.
Well, I hope you got a sense today that, you know, I have been through a range of emotions about all of this. I am very disappointed, I'm numbed by it, but I'm also galvanised by it. I do feel that these credit market write-downs have overshadowed the strengths of this business in this half year. And I hope you get a sense from the slide, not just of my determination to get us out of this place, but all of my colleagues sitting around the room today. We don't enjoy being in this place, but we do have a business here which is strong and resilient, and it's a business that we're taking forward to get ourselves out of this situation.
Maybe you need to be a bit of a masochist, but you know, it's when things are tough that you really, really do see organisations perform. And you know, in the midst of this, there are still lots of opportunities out there. You know, if we can drive the businesses properly forward, this can be differentiating ultimately. So, yeah, I'm a great believer in adversity actually sorting out who the long-term winners are going to be.
RBS had grown until it could grow no more, to become briefly the biggest bank in the world by assets, and now its bloated size left the bank vulnerable. The one golden rule of banking was that every night banks must be able to cover their balance sheet either from their own cash or through loans from other banks. The ABN AMRO takeover doubled the size of RBS's balance sheet, took it to nearly £2 trillion in over 50 countries, at precisely the wrong time. Credit crunch turned into a financial crisis, and the markets seized up. RBS had run out of options. Its cash reserves drained on ABN AMRO. Its share price dropped like a stone. But other banks wouldn't lend to it. The Bank of England was keeping it afloat. Confidence evaporated, and for a few days, the entire banking system teetered on the brink. RBS came within 2 hours of running out of money and bringing down the British financial system with it.
Yes, I'm angry at the Royal Bank of Scotland and what happened. Almost all the losses are in the subprime market in America and related to the acquisition of the bank EMB Anglo.
The rescue plan, sir. What have you agreed?
RBS was forced to accept a £20 billion bailout from the UK government, paid for by the British taxpayer. One condition of the bank being bailed out was that Fred Goodwin leave the company.
Are you sorry?
You'll hear later.
Before he left, he had to face RBS's shareholders one last time. Shareholders who had seen over 90% of the value of their shares vanish during his reign.
There's a lot of people been waiting for this. I know you said you were speaking on behalf of the board, but he's had ample opportunity over the last few months, and there's a lot of unhappy people out here. I'd like to hear him say sorry.
Well, I can only ask Sir Fred to say whatever he chooses to say.
Well, Mr. Black, I wouldn't want there to be any doubt in anyone's mind at all, other than I'm extremely sorry that this has come about. I echo entirely the sentiments that the chairman expressed on behalf of all of the board earlier on. This is something about which I am extremely sorry. And it's extremely sad to be leaving the company at these extremely difficult times. There can be no question other than that I am extremely sorry.
Thank you, Fred.
Location that, please.
There are probably, I don't know, 20,000 people in Scotland. We built up a little nest egg. That nest egg was blown out the water. There's lots and lots and lots of people who've actually been affected. And that hurts me, actually, because I don't think that needed to happen.
It didn't have to happen this way. We didn't have to try and become the biggest bank in the globe, and if we'd have been a little bit more prudent and a little bit more careful, of course we could have avoided the storm, and should have avoided the storm.
Incredibly sad, bemused as to how it could possibly happen. And when my father died, I discovered all his shares were in the Royal Bank of Scotland, the Essex Glaswegian. That's where he felt the comfortable place to be was. And so many other people must have had their capital there. And I just felt this is not just a tragedy for the bank and for the employees, but for Scotland.
Human being, did you feel disappointed, angry, upset?
I was obviously disappointed, and I was obviously upset, angry, not really.
When it all played out, Fred wasn't alone leaving the bank. Johnny Cameron's banks incurred operating losses of nearly £11 billion. He resigned, foregoing a payoff, and eventually agreed not to hold a full-time high financial office again. Tom McKillop followed him out the door a few months later, also without a payoff. Larry Fish retired. He hadn't done subprime mortgages. He had portfolio of other investments, worth around $10 billion, which later turned toxic. He left RBS with a pension pot of $27 million. And Fred? Well, everyone knows about Fred's pension.
Fred's pension entitlement has been widely reported at $650,000. Our remuneration report won't go out for another 10 days or so, but the actual number is $693,000. So the media speculation is slightly lower than the actual amount.
Fred eventually agreed to reduce his pension to £340,000 per year. A fine reward for running up total losses of £24.1 billion. And there, in a nutshell, is what happened inside the bank that ran out of money.
Is that all there is? Is that all there is? If that's all there is, my friend...
It's the biggest source of conflict in relationships, as a group of couples explain. Tomorrow night, money is at 9 here on BBC Two. Cilla Black is guest host next tonight for Nevermind the Buzzcocks.
If that's all...